first speaker, who I have the distinct pleasure of knowing for many years from the very beginning when he started and established yoga, you know, in this DC area. And so Dr. Rajan Narayanan is one of the founders and inspiration behind the formation of Life in Yoga Institute, which many of you know, and the foundation. He has developed the Life in Yoga 5x3x1 approach. You can ask him for what it is. He has expounded on that before, and he has written about that too. And the techniques of CRE, breath, dance yoga, and gentle yoga. And just to add a little digression from introducing him, we at Georgetown University Medical Center in 1995, we started teaching mind-body medicine. And we incorporated, I was one of the part of the faculty of introducing yoga and meditation to the medical students and nurses, and which has been a major effort to be able to get them understand, you know, our practices in terms of practice. And Rajan has done yeoman service in terms of what he has done with the university, with the doctors, as well, and the patients and people. He has also translated and written a commentary on the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali. He has studied yoga techniques from Maharishi Mahesh Yogi Institute, Sachidananda Ashram in Yoga Will, and Swami Vua of New York. He is also a Reiki master and pranic healer, and has been trained by Dr. Asanta Krishna Swami of Chennai, India. In December 2009, Swasya Vivekananda University honored him for his innovative and original contributions in the field of yoga. His current area of research is in the area of measurement of nadis of yoga using EAV instruments. And in his approach to analysis, he views the impact of yoga in 5 areas, and he will, you know, mention more about that. And the title of his presentation is Roots of Pluralism in Hinduism and its consequent impact on freedom and diversity of practice. You have all of 20 minutes. He can talk about this for hours, but just got 20 minutes. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.
And also, after you finish your discussion, you know, take your seat right here. And so that way, you know, all the panel members can be.
If you don't mind, I'll take my seat right now.
You feel, please. That's why I gave you the opportunity.
Not realize I'm running a flu. So that's the reason I prefer to sit down. And
can you turn off this mic?
Yes. So in the topic that we have today, this topic, I will take a slightly different approach from what has been taken in understanding Hinduism. If you look across lot of Hindu-related work, you will find on one hand, there is in the academic side, people have a certain way of looking at Hinduism. And then on the religious side, they have a different way of looking at Hinduism. And this is something most of you who have looked at the academic side know how it's different from the religious side. However, there is a third side, which actually can integrate both of them together. And that is really what I call the spiritual side or the yoga side. So it is the yoga side that I'm going to talk about. And when I speak from the yoga side, I will very comfortably borrow from the academic side as well as from the religious side to bring them together. So in a nutshell, I'm going to make a very bold statement that Hinduism is the coming together of 33 religions. And that is why there is plurality on it. Plurality is the essence of Hinduism that has come right from the start. It came because of the great wisdom of the great Rishi Vyasa, who had the wisdom to understand that it is unity in diversity by which humanity exists. And so he really found the mechanism for people to rise above, I wear this kind of clothes, I do this, that, I worship this god or whatever. He brought all of them together. And where is the evidence for this claim? That is what I am going to share with you as you go along. And once we have been through that, then in which case, the rest of what follows, the questions that were raised as part of the seminar, they just fall out very, very easily. So the five questions that were raised in this program when Dr. Rishi Chandra sent out the request was, what are the critical elements in the Hindu thought philosophy?
Keep going.
What are the critical elements in the Hindu thought philosophy, structure and scriptures that promote freedom and diversity of concepts and practice? Second question, pros and cons of this approach and safeguards against proselytizing traditions and contradictions and conflict in the absence of central authority, how do you handle it? Is it necessary for a non-Hindu to formally convert to Hinduism, to accept Hindu Dharma? What can be done to promote Hindu thoughts, values and practices without conversion? Once we answer this question over here, all the rest of them very easily fall out. So the bulk of what I'm going to be presenting in the next 10 minutes is really this, and then another 5 minutes to wrap up the rest. So the approach to understand what are the critical elements is the texts of Hinduism and understanding the origins of Hinduism. Many of you have heard that from the perspective of Hinduism, they will say that Vedas are the real source of Hinduism, at least from an academic perspective. They recognize any school of thought that accepts the Vedas, that would be accepted as a school of Hinduism. And the idea from the religious side, they will say all of this, Vedas and all of this, are anadi and apaurusheya. Anadi, from the perspective of people who come from the religious side, is that it has no beginning. It was always there. And then the concept of apaurusheya is it is not of human origin, so about God. I have a slightly different way of looking at it. The concept of anadi means you don't know where the source is. And the concept of apaurusheya means what we would say if something is written and the author is anonymous, then anonymous. So that is my way of looking at it. So you can see how when we look at it, the religious way versus the academic way that I'm coming in between over here. So if to begin with that, the text, I'm beginning first with the Vedas. There are a lot more texts than the Vedas, but the Vedas are considered the core texts of Hinduism. Right? Now, besides the Vedas, there are actually many more things in there, but let's ponder for a moment on the Vedas. How many of you know that the Vedas in itself only has yajna, fire-based worship, and no temple worship is prescribed in the Vedas? How many of you know that? Okay. But it looks like by the number of hands, it's about 20% of the crowd here, 80% were not aware that temple worship is not part of the Vedas. Now, the next subject I'm going to raise for you is that if you look at the way in which temple worship is done, you all know the way in which worship is done at Mangal Mandir is distinctly different from the way it is done at Shiva Vishnu temple, and it may yet be somewhat different from the way it may be done at the Hindu temple. And why is it you have all these different traditions and where do they come from? And that is, there are 33 agamas. When we say agama, the meaning of agama from Sanskrit is what has come from before. That's all it means. And in fact, people will even refer to Vedas as agama because what has come from before. So anything which we have inherited from our ancestors is agama. So the 33 agamas that refer to the systems of worship that are there are essentially the 33 original religions, in my opinion, that were all brought together in the a single form of worship. Now, if you look at the worship pattern, whether it is in this temple or in Shiva Vishnu temple or in Hindu temple or any of the temples around, you will find they will all be using in some part of their ceremony or a lot of part of their ceremony, the hymns which are all there in the Vedas. So the hymns are being used from the Vedas, but yet on the other hand, there is no prescription for worship in a temple or a murti that is not there in the Vedas. So what form of worship is prescribed in the Vedas? In the Vedas, it is all fire-based, oven-based worship. And many of you who are familiar, many of you here are from Punjab and you are familiar with the Arya Samaj approach, where the Arya Samaj approach, all worship is only oven-based, right? And so, because that is completely on the Vedic side. And what kind of these fire-based things are prescribed in the Vedas? We have heard of many, but may not have seen Ashwamedha Yajna. You know, you might have heard of our famous Prime Minister Vajpayee, who was there. He comes from a family who should have been traditionally of Vajpayee Yajna. Yes, and there are other ones like, you know, Agni China and various other things. These are the ones which are there in the Vedas. So the temple, you can understand, if in the temple worship we are drawing on the hymns, really this wise person Vyasa, he brought all of them together, he included all of them. But when you are trying to bring 33 religions together, one religion calls their god Shiva, another religion calls their god Vishnu, and all of them, what do you do? The thing is basically, one has this form, the other has a different form. So make fire as the common denominator so that nobody needs to fight. And then after doing all of that, what did he do? He wrote the 18 Mahapuranas and the 18 Upapuranas. And he made every god form that was available part of one great family. Everybody is related to everyone else, right? And so the thing is, we can see in the other thing which we want to get into is the timing of Vyasa and roots of Hinduism. Of course, from the academic side, the Vedas are, you know, they will say the Rig Veda is what? Around 100 CE or something like that, they say, or the some BC or something like that. But on the other hand, when it comes to our accurate understanding today, the accurate understanding is really based on hardcore data. If we think in terms of the Vedas reference to the Saraswati River, the person in January 2016 who was given Padma Bhushan, yes, Padma Bhushan or Padma Vibhushan, you know, one of the top one, his name was K.S. Waldia, Kuldeep Singh Waldia. And this person was the geologist who did the scientific work to determine when exactly the Saraswati River disappeared. And it was flowing from a place called Shatrana in Punjab, coming down, that is where the split occurred, and it used to come to Somnath Parvat, that is where it entered the Arabian Sea. And then of course, it disappeared because of two tectonic shifts and the water was captured by the Indus River, the Sindhu River reed, and the Yamuna. And that's how all of that changed. But anyway, the another hardcore element in the timing is that we have today real, the carbon dating technology which is used for anything fossil based, as well as anything that is pottery which has been baked, they use a technology called fluoroluminescence technology by which they can date how or when was the pottery created. And so with these technologies they have been able to date artifacts and things much more accurately than the Oxford school who based upon the Indus Valley civilization created various dates at that point in time. And then of course we have had some excellent research that was done by people who looked at the astronomical observations in the Mahabharata war, or in Mahabharata, and they were able to look in terms of where exactly these positions could be replicated nearest to our current era. And based upon this today, there is overwhelming evidence that the Mahabharata period was between 3100 and 3200 BC. So we are really talking like about 5100, 5200 years back is when the Mahabharata, this thing occurred. And we all know that Sage Vyasa was really the biological grandfather of the Kauravas and the Pandavas. And we know he was there at that time and he wrote the Mahabharata, right? So today we know we can tie Vyasa to that period of time. And Vyasa, had a very unique, when Vyasa compiled the Vedas together to bring these religions together, at the same time, at that point in time, he wrote a, but obviously he has created this Vedas to bring the religions together, the ritual part on the Brahmanas and Samhita, and then some of the discussions that go slightly more beyond but not the highest philosophies in the Aranyaka, and the highest philosophy of existence is in the Upanishads. And so that he is able to bring the validity of the Upanishad together, he wrote the Brahma Sutras. And the understanding of the Brahma Sutras is today called Vedanta, because that is what the full summary understanding of the Vedas. So now, Vedanta is considered the last of six darshanas or six philosophies that existed in India. Chronologically, it is the last. Previous to that, there are five other philosophies, and the immediate predecessor of Vedanta is Yoga. And what is different about the Vedanta philosophy versus many of the others, except for one, the Mimamsa philosophy, is that the Vedanta philosophy, coming from the Vedas, both is philosophy, at the same time the religious part of it is there in the Brahmanas and Samhita. Whereas if we look at Yoga, Yoga is only a philosophy of Yoga Sutras of Patanjali. There is no religious practice associated with it. And Vyasa wrote a commentary on the Yoga Sutras. Now what has happened is, within the religious side of the world, many people feel nothing can be older than Vyasa and the Vedas. And because they feel nothing can be older than Vyasa and the Vedas, they would say it couldn't have been the same Vyasa who wrote the commentary on the Yoga Sutras. Okay? Because the moment religion comes in and the faith comes in, everything changes. So the coming here, we can understand that he wrote the commentary on the Yoga Sutras. If you read it, you will find the message of the Brahma Sutras is identical to the commentary on the Yoga Sutras. And you will also find it is exactly the same message of Bhagavad Gita. And all of you know, the Bhagavad Gita is considered the summarized understanding of Upanishads as well, right? So that is where, so the starting point is Hinduism is the coming together of 33 religions, and that is the base of the plurality of Hinduism. And now we can go to answer each one of these questions. So understanding where this comes from is all of us practice the way we want, and it gives us the freedom. But there's one other thing that has happened in the academic side. Hindu scholars have determined that Hinduism allows you to understand the nature of existence in three different ways. All of them you can integrate or take them in whichever way you want. One, the basis of knowledge is the Vedas. The Vedas and the Upanishad and all of these things are telling us what is the nature of existence in living. The second one is your own spiritual experience has equal validity as the Vedas. In fact, in some schools, they will say, you have to understand the Vedas according to your own spiritual experience. That's what gives you real understanding of it. And then the third one is any inferences you draw from that. So in other words, in the Hindu tradition, each one of us have our own authority and ability to interpret things based upon our own spiritual experience. And now we have to understand the Upanishads were really the experience of various rishi sages of the past. And so, but the way in which Hinduism has been constructed, there is no injunction why we shouldn't have sages in the future too, who cannot interpret and understand it in the same way, right? So that is where the plurality and the freedom. The plurality comes from the different, and the freedom comes from the way in which we have ability to interpret it. Now, the pros and cons of this pluralistic approach is, people who don't have spiritual maturity can get confused. And the way in which we deal with that is, we have to be, as a community, Dr. Kiran Parikh and Dr. Shiv Sobhamme explained about the nature of, Dr. Parikh explained about how Hinduism, the numbers as a percentage are not this thing. So, as a group, as a community, we need to do that education. And the part about, once educated, of course, it's a safeguard against proselytizing traditions. And when there are contradictions and conflicts, and here there are some examples too, is when we hear about people in India somewhere there is somebody had beef or something and people go after them and beat them up or kill them and things like that has happened. What we must understand is, in any situation there will be the very rigid group, and then the other side of it is, you will have the people who have the wisdom. And the people who have the wisdom need to guide the people who are rigid and move along from there in the absence of a central authority. That's the way to deal with it. And is it necessary for a non-Hindu to formally convert to Hinduism to accept Hindu Dharma? My view is not at all. I'll give you an example from this morning. I was completely shocked. And I think one of our colleagues here was there also at the yoga session this morning. I do a lot of traveling. And when I'm not traveling, one of the other people substitute. And in fact, if you come to our yoga class at Shivaji Temple on Saturday mornings, 50% of the people are of non-Indian origin. And the teacher who very often substitutes when I'm not there is a person from Bolivia. His name is Athanasio. And so today, because I was not feeling well, so Athanasio was leading the session. And at the end of the session, I had not been in any of Athanasio's sessions before. At the end of the session, I was shocked. He said, now let's all do the Gayatri Mantra together three times. He chanted the Gayatri Mantra. Then he chanted the Mahamrityunjaya Mantra three times. And then he ended with three Oms. Now, if that is a person you want to think about, what is the meaning of, is it necessary for a non-Hindu to convert, that's an example of what is happening. Okay? And then, what can be done to promote Hindu thoughts and values and practices without conversion? The answer to that is yoga. I think yoga is going to change the whole world. With yoga, everybody can become Hindu. And yet, you don't need to have the label of Hinduism within it. Do I have 30 seconds?
You got it.
Okay. I'm going to share with you a story about understanding the nature of Hinduism. We have in Life and Yoga Institute, we have our greatest amount of work we do is actually in Houston. And the reason we do it in Houston is one person who is perhaps the largest Hindu donor in America who was suffering from chronic fatigue syndrome for 35 years, we were able to reverse it. One of the three elements we do in Houston is we run an employee benefit program in that company, which is there for the employees and their family members. And one of the wives of an employee was our patient who was coming in. This person was a highly religious person. And this person is so religious and everything has to be perfect. The person will do multitasking in religion. You know, so she'll be doing one practice while she will play the bhajan at the same time because she doesn't have time. She has to do everything and do it. Okay? And this person, to me from that, I told the husband privately in April when she came to me, I don't have much hope for your wife. You know, she has all health problems. I don't have much hope for your wife. She's too rigid. She's unable to let go. And the key element of yoga is you have to let go and the divinity will reveal. So what happened is, this time when I went, after Harvey came, Hurricane Harvey, their home was flooded. They lost their home. And now, of course, the last few months they have been living and they'll continue to live for a few more months with a relative of theirs. And there they don't have any flexibility for her to do all her rigidity. She has become liberated and her health has improved. Her body, mind, everything has improved. So you can understand what different ways in which yoga plays its part. I'll quickly mention over here that we have our 20th anniversary of yoga at Shivaji Temple. And these are the topics over there. They're blurred out a little bit. This is the philosophy of yoga, the science of yoga, arts of yoga, and benefits of yoga. This is what it is. And so this sheet was given out, so please make note of it. And with that, I'll end over here. Thank you.